Hi, everyone. I am Carrie Little, and I want to thank you for joining me for this homebuyer virtual workshop. While you're watching me live, tell me in the feed, how did you find out about this private Facebook group just for you? Whether you're buying your first home, your second home, whether you're an investor, whether you are someone looking to get into real estate, whether you're looking to sell your first home, your second home, whether you're thinking about moving to Florida. Tell me how you found out about this live session and invite a friend. Okay, so let's talk about homeownership. You know, sometimes you'll see me post on social media or you'll see me on TikTok or you'll get a direct mail piece from me and it might say, warning, renting is hazardous to your wealth. I really want you to understand that if you don't own, you are not building wealth. So let's jump right into this. Now, I am the co-owner of Curemark Realty Group. We are in Illinois and Florida. I am the designated, even though it's spelled wrong, don't worry about it. I know, I at least I can see it now. You gotta love tech and I own my typo. So I'm the designated managing broker of Curemark Realty Group. And I am the co-owner and Mark is the co-owner of Curemark Realty Group. I've been in the real estate industry now since 97. I worked for a builder. And for those of you that are like, Carrie, that's bugging me, I'll fix it right now for you. I will tell you, I've also worked for McDonald's East Coast Real Estate Division. I worked for a brokerage for 16 years. And then the cool thing is, because of my husband, I started a real estate business back in 2017. So we have been in the industry now, well, over 21 years. If you count my 3 years before I was licensed, when I worked for a builder, it's been at least 25 years plus. So again, we want to thank you for joining us. And you can also find us on curemarkrealty.com. So let's get into it. So this is what we're going to talk about today. And even while you're watching live, I want you to know I want to talk to you about dreaming big. I want to talk to you about, this is going to bug me because I don't see the full screen. That's all right. I want to talk to you about I want to talk to you about financing the home. I'm going to talk to you, even though I said dream big already, your wish list. And it is okay if your wish list changes. I'm going to talk to you about working with us, your realtor. We're going to talk about disclosures. We're going to talk about neighborhood information. We're also going to talk about previewing homes and selecting a home, working with an attorney. Now, in Illinois, we typically work with attorneys, and in Florida, not so much. Now, you can hire an attorney. It doesn't matter what state you're in, but it really depends on the market you're buying in. If you are here because you were invited by a friend and you're not buying in Illinois or Florida where we have offices, I want to tell you it is okay. You can still send us a message. You can still call us and we can refer you to a realtor partner in another state. We'll talk about home inspections, appraisals. We'll talk about the final walkthrough and we will talk about closing on your home. So we're going to go over the full process, even when you get to the point where you're ready to buy and writing a contract. So when I say dream big, I really want you to dream big. Think outside the box. When I went to purchase my first home back in the late 90s, I worked for a company called NEC Technologies. And my route home, I would see this one house and I really wanted this house. Like, I'm like, that's the perfect house. It was big. It was pretty. It was on a busy street, but I didn't care. It was just big and pretty. And I wanted this house. So because I love this house because of the way it looked, I wasn't thinking about the neighborhood, local amenities, transportation, access to shopping and highways. That wasn't important to me. I just wanted a house. But I want you to pause, even though you're like, boom, I really want this house. I want you to take a second, think about what is important to you. So when I say, dream big, I want you to think about what is important to you, because what's important to me might not be important to you. When I purchased my first house, what was important to me was I just wanted a home. I just needed it to be affordable. So you might take a second and say, you know what? Location, easy access to highways, affordability. And affordability is not a bad word. It just means what you can afford. Is space important? Room sizes, the home office, backyard, interior property features, exterior property features, programs for the family, education. Like, write, you know, get a pen, get a notebook, right? Get a notebook and write down your dream scenario for your house. For me, when I think about it, Park District was important to me. A swimming pool was important to me, and public transportation. Now, at the time, I was looking for what was affordable. But as I started to look, I found the affordability, but I also realized that we have a train in the city I live in. We have a big swimming pool, outdoor pool that looks similar to the Great Wolf Lodge in Wisconsin Dells. So, and I, when I think about it, this becomes important when I sell. So when I say dream big and what's important to you, you really need to take a second and go, okay, I might want this house bad enough. And you might say, I'm never moving. And if that's okay, you don't ever have to move. And being on a busy street might be okay. But I want you to pause and say, can I sell this house later? Sometimes we get so excited about buying that we don't think about the future. But here's what you should know. If you buy a house today, because remember last month when we talked about house hacks, that house that you currently own could become your investment property and a rental later. So take a moment. What's important to you? Then let's talk about how will you finance the home? Do you have cash in the bank? Are you pre-qualified? Are you pre-approved or fully underwritten? Cash means you have cash in the bank. Cash in the bank, not a hard money loan, which we'll talk about in the future when we get to when we talk about investing, it means it's your money in the bank. Now, if your parents are buying it, they write the offer, you write the offer, they're on the contract with you, it could still be cash. So just know cash is cash in the bank, not someone else's money, maybe your parents. Pre-qualified and pre-approved. So when I have you talk to a lender, there's a difference between being pre-qualified, pre-approved, and fully underwritten. There are different types of loans. There are FHA loans. There's a VA loan. There are conventional loans. There are loans that are conforming or non-conforming. So next month, I'm going to interview a loan officer to go into details. But here's what I want you to know. You call me today, right? You call me today. And you're like, Carrie, I'm ready to buy. And my question is okay, where are you at in the process? And you say, well, I haven't done anything. Okay, have you talked to a loan officer? No, I'm paying with cash. Okay, got it. And my standard process is I'm also going to ask you for proof of funds. Now you're going to scratch out your bank account information. You can go to your bank and get a letter that says, yes, Carrie has the money in the bank. She can buy with cash. Pre-qualified means you've called a mortgage company, a bank, a mortgage broker, a lender, and they pre-qualified you based on the information you provided. Pre-approved means you've turned in all of your paperwork. They have put you through something called digital underwriting, or you've turned in all of your paperwork, meaning W-2s, 2 years worth of your taxes, your 1040s, depending on how you work. You've also turned in pay stubs. You've turned in bank statements. Now that's just a basic list. Your mortgage company might ask for more information and they probably will, but they have pretty much previewed your documents. Now, fully underwritten means you have turned in everything that the mortgage company has asked for. However, they have given your paperwork to an underwriter, not digital underwriting. Digital underwriting means they put it into a computer system, hit go, kind of, I'm summarizing. And then the system spit out or came back and says, yes, this person can be pre-approved digitally. When we talk about being fully underwritten, your loan officer, we're going to make it up, has taken your paperwork, walked down the hall, and put it on the underwriter's desk. It probably doesn't work that way today. It might get uploaded into a secure system. And the underwriter takes all of your documents and they look at everything. all of your documents and they say, yes, they have pulled your taxes. They have made sure everything is true. Everything you've added to your application. So financing the home, if you're getting a mortgage, you've probably gone online, fill out an application, right? You may have paid money. And then the lender has given your paperwork to a physical underwriter, a person who verifies everything. And then they have conditionally approved you to buy. So fully underwritten is almost like cash, because now, depending on where you buy, you need a contract on a house. So you need a house. You will need an appraisal and an inspection. Now that's a perfect world. You might need some other updated documents, but you are a stronger buyer than being pre-approved or being pre-qualified. So when we go to write an offer, I'm going to recommend mortgage companies to you. And then when they take you through the process of being fully underwritten, when you write an offer, it is almost like cash. You are at a point where you might be able to close in 20 days or less, depending on the market and how busy we are. Now, we talked about dreaming big. I do want you to take a moment and really think about what you want. If you're like, Carrie, look, I just need a townhouse. I don't want to cut grass. That's my wish list. But your wish list might be that you want 3 bedrooms, 2.5 baths, a 2-car garage that's attached with a full basement and a backyard. That could be a part of your list. Another part of your list might be that you want public transportation. And it could be within minutes from your house. It could be in the same city. You might also say, I want an open floor plan. You might even say, I want great schools. Now, this is where I would probably refer you to the school district so you can call and get information. Schools might be important to you. But when we say schools, it might also be, because where I bought, we're in one school district. So the school district we live in, we don't compete for grant money. Down the street, there's a different school district where you have like, I'm going to make up the number, let's say like 7 schools or 4 or 5 high schools. If one school applies for a grant, they have to split it equally. Now you might say, well, Carrie, that makes no sense to me. Let me explain it like this. The school, high school district that my kids were in applied for a grant from General Mills. When they won the grant, they didn't have to share that money with another school, because they're in one school district. So that also means that when they got the money, they built rock climbing. I can't quite call it a tightrope, but they did things to help the kids in just that school district. So if schools are important to you, I always say, call the school district. Don't Google school scores. Call the school district and get a breakdown of the scores, because the school district you decide to move into or around might have programs that are available that your kids can benefit in. Like they might have early education. They might have Suzuki programs. Like we have a program in the area I live in where 3-year-olds can start playing the violin. We have a dual language program where kids, if they opt in and they get accepted, they can start learning another language in kindergarten. So the sky's the limit. Like we even have programs for autistic kids. So you really need to take a second and think about what that means. Is shopping important? Are park districts important? Take a second and write down your wish list. Then you're going to probably work with either Mark or Ryan. I get to help them out. So this is our team. And so Mark, he's really the true investor. Ryan is, he's my oldest child, but they will help you buy or sell your properties. And then you get me in the background because I help them with data. Now, other things when we start the process is we are going to send out to you the lead-based paint brochure, the radon brochure, and a brochure on fair housing and disclosure, residential disclosure. Because when you go to write an offer on a home, you're going to want to know what all of this means. So in Illinois, we give you brochures to help you with that. But then when we sit down and go over the process again, we tell you the importance of, if you buy a home, this is really in any state older that was built prior to 1978, it could have lead paint in it. If you buy a home after 1978, we're still going to talk to you about it, but you won't have that disclosure. So in Illinois, we give you a residential disclosure. This is signed by the seller, lead-based paint disclosure, and a radon disclosure. And we can't violate fair housing. So wherever you want to live is where we help you. Now, when we talk about neighborhood info, as a real estate agent, I've had people say, Carrie, would you live here? And I have to pause. There is so much conversation around fair housing that as real estate agents, we can't steer you into a certain area. But what I can say to you is we talked to you about your wish list. We've talked to you about dreaming big. We talked to you about how to get, you know, calling the school district to get a breakdown of the school scores, because you might have a school, you might have data based on dual language, bilingual, and gen ed, and then early childhood education. And gen ed means, well, it means kids that are taught in English. So when we say neighborhood info, you're going to take a moment and you're going to do your own research. Now, I can simply say Google is your best friend. Could be. But I want you, because we have, I have a list of places you might click on the school district, you can call the city, you can call the park district. Do your own research to make sure this is where you want to be. So when someone says, Carrie, would you live here? I tell you why I live where I live. And the biggest reason for me was it was affordable. I didn't know anything about the school district at the time because my oldest went to a private school because I needed him to have before school care and after school. So that was what was important to me. And you might say, Carrie, school districts don't apply because I want my kid to go to school 10 minutes from my job, and I might put them in a magnet school or a private school or, so you might basically a Montessori school. So you might have to have before school care and after school care, but it doesn't mean you can't get it from the public school district. So do your own research is my biggest tip. And then if you don't know how to find it, ask us, and then maybe we can help you, you know, do some research to find the information. But it is very important. You are living in this house, so you need to do your own research. Now, once you have been fully underwritten, right, you've given me your dream list, we're going to go look at houses. Now, we are going to create an automated search for you in our multiple listing service. We're going to give you access to HomeSnap so you can shop on your own. Our multiple listing service allows you to shop as well. So we're going to schedule the appointments for you. Now, if you see a house you like and you click this heart, because that tells me you want to see it. If you click this heart and you want to see it, I have to now go make sure we can get into the property the same day. So I always tell you, my client, make sure you give me time to schedule appointments, because we might have 10 buyers that we're working with. And so we need to plan accordingly to make sure you can get in the home. And you might have a seller that says 24 hours notice. Just because a home is available for sale, it doesn't mean that it's available right now. Now, there could be homes that are vacant where we can get in right away. So we're going to schedule appointments. We will add you to our calendar. And I need you to allow time to schedule. And I need you to arrive on time. I know, believe it or not, arrive on time. If you're running late, you have to let us know so we can contact the agent, because we can't go in early or late. And some agents and sellers only give us 15 minutes to get to the home and preview the home. Some sellers give you a half an hour and maybe even an hour or 2 hours. So it really depends on the showing time for the appointment. And you have to remember it's somebody else's house, not your house, somebody else's house. So when we go to preview homes, I need you to think about that. We're going to keep everyone together. We're going to keep the kids together. We are going to preview the home. And I'm going to give you a sheet of paper that you can write on, or I'm going to send you a link. Depends on you. If you're like, Carrie, I'm not tech savvy, we're going to take notes. Because if you love the home, I'm going to tell you it is okay to write an offer on the first house you see. Really, it is, believe it or not. And you might say, no, Carrie, if that house might not come back. So yes. So now you found the house you love. We're going to write an offer on a contract. When we write the offer on the contract, then we negotiate with the seller. And the seller might just accept your offer. Once the seller accepts the offer, and there are more steps in between, but we'll talk about that when you reach out to the office. Once the seller accepts your offer, then depending on your market, we're probably scheduling an inspection. Once the inspection is completed, we are working with your attorney in Northern Illinois. In Florida, we're working with you. And then we, if there are any issues in the inspection, we're going to work with the attorney or the listing agent. Now, this is where we really get into the contract, because there are some things that aren't negotiable, but I always say everything's negotiable, but we have to pause to say, you might say, well, Carrie, I don't like the color of the cabinets. That can't be a deal killer, because if you love the home, guess who's fixing the cabinets? You are. So you want to, when we look at inspection issues, we need to make sure the house is safe. Safety first, but it doesn't mean that you don't ask the seller to give you a credit to repaint the house, because the whole house is painted in the ugliest color you can think of. And the other ugliest color you can think of might not be the ugliest color I can think of. I know, you're like, really? No, we all think differently. Then, so you've written the offer, you're under contract, you've scheduled the inspection, we've negotiated the inspection issues. Now we move forward, and then you are working with your loan officer. And then if you haven't turned in all your paperwork, or if you're fully underwritten, the mortgage company might ask for updated pay stubs and updated bank statements to make sure you haven't spent your down payment. And we haven't talked about when you spend money yet. And then once everything is complete, you have your appraisal, the house appraises, then you have a clear to close. Let me give you a tip. If you are not working, maybe you're putting down cash, you still might want to have an appraisal. It's up to you. Do you have to? No, but you might want to. Some other things that I'm not talking about here are flood zones. There are things that we don't think about when we buy with cash. You want to make sure that you have the right insurances in place. So other things that happen when you work with your loan officer or your attorney or the agent is we might need to make sure you have homeowners insurance, because what if something happens and you need to rebuild? If you're getting a mortgage, you must have insurance. Okay. And then once you have a clear to close, now, if you're working in escrow, you're turning all of your paper to the title company, they're helping you out. Once you are ready to close, the closing date is scheduled. Now, in different markets, you could close today, but you can't get in for 5 days. In Illinois, if you get the keys today, you can move in, unless there was a clause on the contract. So before you're clear to close, there's another step called the final walkthrough. So now you've done everything, you have a clear to close. Well, you have your clear to close. So before you close, your final walkthrough takes place. So we go back to the property. Depending on the contract might say that the home has to be left in broom clean condition. Now, I always debate this. Like, I'm always wondering what people think about when they think of in broom clean condition. To me, it means dusted, clean, perfect. For some, it just means you swept enough. For some, it means they left furniture in the house. It really means the house should be empty. So you go to the final walkthrough to do a few things. We want to make sure that everything that was on the inspection list that the seller said they were going to repair is done, right? They said they were going to repair the outlets near the kitchen sink, and we want to make sure that was done. They said that they were going to replace the hot water tank. Great. We got receipts. It was done. We want to make sure that the water pressure is back to normal. Done, right? You flush the toilet, looks good. Turn on the sinks, looks good, right? You get to the house, and there's furniture still in the house. Right away, you need to deal with the listing agent or the attorney, depending on where you buy. You need to make sure that they're going to get all of this out. And the attorney or the title company might hold money back in escrow to make sure it's done. Because if it's not done and the new buyer has to make those updates or repairs, we want to make sure we have the money. So closing day. In many markets, you get the keys the same day. My sister, who's in California, if she closed today, she has 5 days before she can move in. So it really depends on your market. And I'm not an expert in California. I'm only telling you what she told me. So make sure you work with us or your agent. And here's what I need you to remember. There are rules to buying. Don't buy any big ticket or spend your down payment money. Don't go let anyone pull your credit while you're purchasing a home, especially if you're getting a mortgage. Here's why. Your down payment must be in the bank when you close. It has to, or when they do, like 3 days before when they verify your assets, because the mortgage company is going to work with you to give you a whole different checklist. So don't spend your down payment and don't buy big tickets. So what do I mean? that you head over to Home Goods and open a credit card. I also mean that you head over to Bob's Furniture, wherever, and you open a new line of credit. You don't want anyone to pull you, take your social security number, run new credit, because it will change your purchase power. I've had buyers do this. The 10 commandments of homeownership is don't let anyone run your credit. Don't spend your down payment. And if you're not sure before you spend money, even on a current credit card. So for example, if I have a credit card that where I can spend $1,000 on it and I have $200 spent, don't go max out that credit card because it changes your purchase power. Don't do anything new. Don't open credit cards. Don't spend your money, your down payment money. Now, even if, because here's some things that we're going to talk about when we interview a loan officer. If I were, let's say you're buying a property, whether you have 3% down, 3.5%, you're 100% because you're VA, you're putting down 10%, 15%, 20% or half. You can ask the seller to pay your closing costs. Oh, you can? You can add the seller to participate. And maybe when we talk to the loan officer, they're going to buy down your rate. So instead of getting a 6% rate, maybe we could buy it down to 5.5. So you can ask the seller to participate. So even though the seller is going to participate with your closing costs, you can't spend the money. It needs to be in the bank. So even if you get to the point where you're going to close and you only need to bring $100 to the closing table, that's not going to happen in every scenario. But if that were the case, your money cannot be spent. Don't spend anything. Don't spend anything. And then ask me when you can spend your money. I know that sounds crazy, but I'm going to say, so I always tell my clients in Illinois, until you get the keys and everything has funded, meaning the mortgage company has sent the money to everyone, right? To the bank, right? To whoever's going to service your loan, until it's done and the seller's been paid, the title company's been paid, the mortgage company, until everyone's been paid, not the mortgage company, but the attorneys, until you have those keys, don't spend any money. And I, some of you might say, well, Carrie, I already know this. Not everyone knows that. I had a client call me once and I heard in the background, like I could tell they were at a car dealership. And I was like, what are you doing? And she was like, oh, I'm at a dealership. I said, why? She was like, my daughter's buying a house. I said, you are. I said, please forgive me, but you're not allowed to co-sign or buy any cars. She was like, she paused. I said, no, seriously, it will change your ability to purchase a home. And she was like, okay, I'm glad I called. So when do you spend money? And it could be, you might spend a little more money in different places. So when you write an offer on a home, you have what is called earnest money. It tells you that you are earnestly interested in the property. There is no perfect scenario. Agents that have been selling longer than me, and I've been licensed for 21 years, will say, Carrie, no, you have to put down 10% of the price of the home. That's not true. That is not true. My husband buys homes without earnest money. It is rare, but it can be done. So if you write an offer on a home, whatever the offer is, you can put down $1,000, $5,000, $20,000. Here's what you should know. The more money you put down, it tells the seller how earnestly you are interested in the property. That check is getting cashed, and that check must come out of your bank account. If it's going to come from someone else, like a gift from a parent, that money has to be sourced. What does that mean? That means if your parent, my mother, is going to give me the earnest money, my mother needs to make sure it comes out of her bank, and she has to fill out a form with the mortgage, with the lender. So we know that the money wasn't in my mattress. I know it sounds crazy, but it has to be sourced. So your cousin, your sister, your brother, your boyfriend, your significant other, the neighbor can't just hand you $1,000 and you put it in the bank. It has to come out of the bank or bank account, and it has to be sourced. Now, can someone else give you the money? That's where I'm going to have you talk to a loan officer. You're probably going to spend money when you complete the application and the loan application with your loan officer. And the loan application might also include the appraisal. You're going to spend money with the inspection or the inspector. Now, this is where, someone else could actually pay the inspector because this doesn't have to be sourced. But I'm cautious about saying this because it might be different in a different state. Closing. when you go to closing, this is where you bring your down payment and the closing costs and any attorney fees, or if you have to reimburse anyone. And when you go to closing, let's say you have to put down 3.5% plus closing costs, you are going to work with your bank. You are never going to click a button on your computer because you can be hacked. You are going to physically go to the bank and work with the bank. Don't ever, ever, ever click, call the bank, because you will, if it's over a certain dollar amount, it might have to be a wire. Earnest money will get also get credited to you. So if you had a $1,000 earnest money check and the listing company is holding it or the title company, that will be credited to you when you close. And don't forget, don't buy any big ticket before closing. All right, so before I end, if you do have questions, type them in the feed. So start the process today. You can call the office, you can email Mark, and you can follow us on social media. So let me remind you, I like to say warning, renting is hazardous to your wealth. You're paying a mortgage. Every time you pay rent, you are paying for someone else's mortgage or investing in someone's wealth. You are building wealth for someone else. If you can't own today, you need to call us so we can put you on the path to homeownership. If you're like, I can't afford it, we can talk to you about affordability and how to help you plan to own. So I want you to remember, monthly, if you are paying $600 a month, for 1 year, you're spending $7,200 on someone else's future. 5 years, $36,000. And then 10 years, $72,000. So the longer you rent, the more money you spend with someone else's property. And here's the cool thing about homeownership is when you own your own home, you get to make the updates. You get to make the changes. You get to put the nails in the wall, because you know if you are currently renting and you put nails in the wall, that landlord is going to try to do everything they can to keep your security deposit. So why not own? Own, you get stability. You have stability and you get to build wealth. And then one day I'll come back and talk to you about pulling cash out of your home and how I don't think you should do that. But we'll talk about that when we get to investing. So your first step, I'm going to say call Mark today. And you can do that either by calling the office or texting or calling his cell phone. And if you want to start the process, but you're not ready to call, you can simply send Mark a text, or you can go to bit.ly/ownwithcaremark, CM, own with CM, Carrie and Mark. So I want to thank you for joining me tonight for another workshop in this private group for all of you. If you have any questions and there's anything else you want to learn, please feel free to type them in the chat, send us a direct message, a private message, or call the office. So again, we want to help you build wealth, and thank you for joining us for this virtual home buyer workshop.